Hi, everyone. Thanks for coming here tonight. I'm Terri Schwartz, entertainment editor at IGN, and we are here tonight to celebrate Grimm's 100th episode. No small feat for any TV show. Before I came here tonight, I actually went back and watched the pilot episode of Grimm, and it is crazy to see how much changed. Literally, the first episode of this show is Hank giving Nick a hard time for not checking out Adalind, the first Vesson he ever saw. Nick was ready to propose to Juliette. We all know how that turned out. And he had just discovered his Grimm powers and gotten the first key. And now we finally found out in this episode what happened with the keys. And of course, that opened up a whole bunch more questions. So without further ado, I want to introduce the cast of Grimm. Kicking things off, David Giuntoli, who plays Detective Nick Burkhardt. We also have, right here, right next to me, we also have Russell Hornsby, who plays Lieutenant Hank Griffin. Woo! Bitsie Tulloch, who plays Juliette Silverton, now Eve. Silas Weir Mitchell, our favorite blue blood, Monroe. Yeah. In the back, Sasha Reese, Captain Renard. Reggie Lee, Sergeant Wu. Woo-hoo! Bree Turner, Rosalie Calvert. And last but certainly not least, Adalind Shed, Claire Coffey.
Time for Excedrin number two.
Now, thank you everyone. Congratulations on 100 episodes.
Very fortunate, thank you.
Thinking back to the pilot when you came on, a pilot, not even a full series order or at that point in time, what were sort of your first thoughts walking onto the set of Grimm?
They have made a terrible mistake with me. here we are at the 100th episode, and I think I can speak for everybody. You don't expect that when you're an actor. And it wasn't even that I didn't think it would go 100 episodes. You don't even think to that concept. You're just kind of excited you have a job. And you want to get through that, and you're excited, you hope it gets picked up, because it's always a question mark until they start ordering season after season. So it's a concept you don't even consider, so we're very grateful.
Now, were you all a fan of genre beforehand, or was this just another pilot that you were going out for?
I had always wanted to do a genre show, because I like watching fantasy, and the fans for genre television are the best. So this was very exciting.
I was not a fan of genre stuff. I mean, particularly. And when you say just another pilot you were doing, it was my second pilot.
Oh, really?
Yeah. I am not Mr. Pilot Season by any stretch.
I hadn't seen, I knew of, obviously, Buffy the Vampire Slayer and Angel, but I hadn't seen it yet. And then I remember every day I wasn't shooting the pilot episode, which was 5 years ago this month in Portland, I was in my hotel room ordering room service watching every single episode of Buffy. It was so good. Big fan.
I will tell you that, I mean, I'm kind of like on Silas's side there, that and it's you know, I wasn't a huge fan, but I tell you as an actor, it's like you sit there and you start imagining these things happen. It is beyond the realm of like any other thing that you'd ever do, because you have to imagine people turning into creatures and stuff. So it's in that regard, it's such a gift to kind of like go beyond, you know. So that's been fantastic. Now I'm a fan.
Well, that's sort of what I was going to ask, because Claire, you brought it up, like the fans of genre are so intense in a different way than, you know, your typical comedy or drama might be. So for those of you who weren't fans of genre and sci-fi and fantasy television, how did you try to relate to your characters in a world that you weren't necessarily a huge fan of beforehand?
It's just the world.
Yeah, and I think the human aspect is where you always begin. I mean, as an actor, you always start kind of with the humanity of it all and then work your way from there and start imagining different situations of that kind of thing happening to you and what you feel. I mean, and I can only speak for my character, so for those that have gone and you've started as Vesson, you know, I don't know what that's even like to start there.
It was like going back to acting class, you know, again, just, the, you know, using your imagination and visualizing, you know, the creatures and, you know, just imagining what they look like and how you should react. It was like just, you know, going back in time, you know, for me. And it was, every day was like an acting exercise, you know, and that's where the joy of coming to work was the joy of coming to work every day.
I remember on the pilot episode I had to do, I had never done anything where my character was scared before, and Mark Buckland, awesome director, was doing it, and I was walking into Nick and Juliette's house, and I like see his aunt, and she pops out and scares me, but she wasn't working that day. And so they're like, oh, just act super crazy terrified. And they put a little pink post-it note on the corner of the mat box so that my eye line would be there. And I'm like, that's the least threatening thing you could possibly put, a pink post-it note. So that was a learning experience of like, what am I going to try to imagine so that I can actually be scared in this moment?
I think what's so cool about our show is that and our showrunners and Norberto Barba, who's our kind of our captain of our ship. Oh, is he here?
Wait.
I'm not even kissing your ass, my friend. I didn't even know you were here. Our amazing captain. You know what he and everyone, you know, I think just the what we always try to do is keep everything in the truth, and I think that's what makes our show really awesome. Is that at times we can be goofy and funny and romantic and silly and scary in this fantasy world, but I think it always comes from the truth, you know, and really keeping it grounded.
What was sort of the learning curve for you guys acting with CGI and makeup, especially with the voguing when you guys get into doing that? Some of that isn't even you, it's stunt doubles who are doing some of the action sequences, and then also, again, you're doing your normal acting, but we see the CGI version of that.
Yeah, the first time I saw myself as a Fuchsbau, I actually was on maternity leave, you know, when my aunt was sick and Rosalie had to go take care of her aunt. The aunt wasn't even at our wedding, so obviously, whatever about her. I was home in LA watching the episode, and it was just so cute. Like, because all the creatures are so aggressive and so violent and like, scary, you know? And so Rosalie's little Fuchsbau face, I was like, oh, that is just so sweet.
I remember when I had to do the first, my first Vogue. It wasn't the first Vogues in the whole thing are in the precinct, right? When you walk in there and you think,
yeah, I think I see some kind of
too, right?
Lizard,
yeah,
type.
I wasn't
going to
say anything.
Oh, yeah. You're the first one ever.
The very
you?
First yeah. scene, yeah.
In the show, but you did it.
Yeah, but I just remember just in terms of like, what are you supposed to do? Like, what is this? You know what I mean? Because
yeah.
you're in
yeah,
like
how does
uncharted.
It?
Yeah, what is it? You're in uncharted territory. You don't know what this is until it just becomes what it is. And we were shooting the pilot, and I did something. I was like, I don't even know. It just felt like, okay, something's coming from my inside, and it's manifesting on the outside. And I was like, what is this? And I went and I looked back at the director and Jim and David, the producers, like under the tent, and I was like. And they just literally, they were like. So it kind of just revealed itself in a way, you know? And now people come up to me and they're like, so how do you Vogue? And I'm like, well, let me tell you. It really, it wasn't something that was figured out beforehand at all.
How about in terms of the terminology, like Silas, you in particular, when we talk and I have to transcribe our interviews afterwards, you just like rattle off all the Grimm and Wesson terminology, like it's nobody's business. What was sort of the learning curve in not only learning the language, which is very much German inspired, but also getting an understanding of the mythology of the show? For everyone, not just for
yeah.
Silas, but.
Silas actually gave me a really great book when I joined the show. What was it?
Oh, it was the werewolf book.
But there I was like the history and the
yeah. There was like it was the werewolf in lore and legend, I think is what it's called. But that's actually the little one. I gave you the big one.
You
right?
mean the big one? I mean, obviously
yeah.
there's the you know the Grimm fairy tales that we tell. But what was cool, you know, when he kind of gave me that book, it opened my mind of like, you know, really like history and where these where you know these are all based in some sort of truth in a way of like people were sick and they didn't know what was happening. So they were like, he's a werewolf, you know, and I think we've gone there in the show about different cultures, lore, and not just straight up grim fairy tales, which has been fun. That's all I have.
There's like a grimmish kind of dictionary now that has been created, right?
Yeah.
I don't have to say the words that often, but we do have somebody who helps us out with that, with the really hard to pronounce ones. And there's like a grim Wikipedia page too.
Whenever I think it became grimmish because I didn't have the capability to speak the German. And so now it's just like some Americanized thing. Also, when you're speaking German, it's not the sexiest of sounds. Like these, like.
But it sounds really like authentic to the world.
Yeah, so.
Well, I remember
Barnyard Animals.
Claire and I, season one, had some, right? You did. You had this guy, season one, too, who was in Germany, who would get like kind of aggressive. I'm like, I didn't even say it. He'd be like, that is not how it is pronounced. This is how you would say it.
On Twitter, do you mean?
Yeah. The guy on Twitter.
Yeah. There is a really.
It's V-son.
Monsters don't exist, too, guys.
Yeah. Well, but my response to him was like, yeah, but we're American. Like, the characters are American. So if we bastardize the German, it kind of makes sense because Americans.
They're not very. They're not a very detail oriented people.
You guys do bring up something really interesting, though, which is 5 years ago when Grimm started, the social media and social media as it relates to TV shows and actors phenomenon is not what it is today. Now there's very much a direct line between people, and you, for the most part, are all really, really active on social media. So how has that affected the job that you're doing, and what have you had to learn about engaging with fans?
Silas? you want to kick this one off?
Yeah, I was actually going to say, I'll take this one. So I don't do it, so thank you.
But everyone else is.
You know, I think for me, when you're on stage all day and there is no audience aside from, you know, the crew who sees you and they're not impressed by you anymore.
or ever.
Yeah, or ever.
Anymore.
It's ever? Funny. I don't know. I like try to dream it up for them. Twitter in particular for me has been a way to actually engage with them and realize that there's an audience, because there's a disconnect when you're, you know, on a soundstage by a river in Portland all day long, and you kind of forget it's being seen. And I've used it for some fun. The best thing I've done lately, though, I was trying to get people to retweet like a bunch of grim things. I'm like, if you guys retweet it 1,500 times, I'll tweet out my phone number and you guys can call.
Not his real phone number.
So it I was bought
not
a, his so real I got a burner from like a Walgreens.
From the Wire.
And then yeah, like
a
just
phone
the wire
number.
Now.
Not my phone. So tweet out a phone number.
So it worked and they were calling and it was crazy. It was wonderful. I think Sasha and I are gonna do that next Friday too.
Yeah, I was there for that when you guys did it. You and Reggie were passing it back and forth. Yeah. What is it like to have that direct line to people and know how you're affecting people or have them yell at you for your pronunciation?
Well, no, actually, you know, for the most part, it's so positive. Yeah. And our fans are so amazing. And I mean, that's why we're here celebrating this 100th episode, is because they are so full on. And honestly, I think it's great. I think everyone has an individual experience with how much personal stuff they want to share with the world. But I think, especially in a genre show like this, I remember thinking I wasn't ever going to do anything like social media. But then this show was handed, and I'm like, well, if I'm ever going to do it, I'm going to do it now, where there's like this built-in fan base, you know. And actually, it's been so fun. I mean, it's a little bit of work, right? But I think for the most part, it's been very positive, and it's just about personal.
It has given us a kind of, you know, it's kind of like Comic-Con every year. It's like gives you a little boost of energy that's like, oh, okay, now we're going to go do the season. We actually see who's watching us and the feedback. And it's nice to see it, like, you know, to live tweet a show, that never used to occur. I mean, so it's kind of nice while it's going on to kind of like talk to them. I would be the first to go, I just want to like stay in character and like not have them reveal. Yeah, I don't. Sometimes I'm like, am I tweeting as Woo? Am I tweeting as Reggie? I have no idea anymore. The line is like blurred. So it's now. But it's so nice to see the response, especially when it's positive. But you know, it's funny because sometimes they will give you like actual, because they're hardcore. So they'll give you like, you know, your character should be doing this right now, and they should be doing this, and you're like, yeah, yeah. And then when it doesn't happen, it's like, wah, wah. But they said this, it should go there. But so it's been, they're so involved. And it's nice to see that it gives you an extra boost of energy, especially season five, you know, you make it fresh. So it's nice to kind of have that.
I was just gonna say that I still marvel at the fact that there are people from literally every corner of the globe that can get access to the show, that could tweet you and interact with you. And it just blows me away. Like when I get a tweet from just the most remote place, like in the middle of Siberia, and you're just like, and I have.
North That's Korea.
True. And it's actually true.
And yeah, and you're just like, are you kidding me? You realize how far reaching it is.
I got fan mail from Tasmania, which is pretty cool.
And you know you made it when. But the other thing I was going to say was, you know, we recently had this charity, online charity through Omaze, and just to see the level of support and the things that you could do such as that, where you could raise a lot of awareness and money, because there's so many wonderful people who want to contribute and want to help, that, you know, that is an incredible tool.
Well, on the flip side of that, like you said, like people might actually send you like, oh, you should be doing this, or this is sort of my interpretation, or what if your character or your portrayal did this? How do you let that affect you, if at all? And also there is, you know, in addition to all the positivity, there can be some negativity on social media. So for new people starting out, like maybe getting their first role, and now there's this direct line between them and the internet, how do you recommend that people put up a buffer?
Yes, I would say people, my role is a little divisive, I would say, amongst the fans.
I mean, people don't just like love Adalind
yes,
from the start?
No, it's 50-50, but 50 the good way. No, but I would say most people are very nice if they're bothering to at reply. It's usually in support. There have been a couple that have like tweeted me saying like, Adalind needs to be off the show. And I'm like, you are misdirecting your tweet. Like, I'm not gonna vote myself off the show. But I do know, like, if I were to just search Adalind, like, don't do that. Like,
don't go looking for trouble.
Yeah, don't go looking for trouble, exactly. As my dad would say, don't go cruising for a bruising. That's, you know. So, but yeah, I mean, and then, you know, you just take it with, you, if you're gonna believe your good reviews, you gotta believe the bad ones too. So just, you know, let it roll off your shoulders for the most part.
I worry about that. I have young kids, and I think about this stuff all the time. Like, how does this shape young people coming up, and especially in this industry where, if you don't have a sense of self, if you don't have your own life first, you're toast.
I was just gonna say that it's about when the boundaries are so permeable between your inner self and the outer world, that's a dangerous thing until you've established like an identity or a sort of an ego boundary. And when kids are like, in this business in particular, if you're 14, 15, 20, whatever you are, you've got to be careful with your soul, because this stuff, I mean, it's hard enough when you're a grown person, let alone when you're basically still an adolescent, to be exposed to stuff like trolling, even, or not even that, but even constructive criticism is like, can be really damaging if it just comes from out of the blue. So yeah. I just want to second that.
Yeah, and I think it just has to be about having fun. So the second it stops being fun, then you stop. And I've gone on breaks, you know, where we're artists. Like, you have to protect your soul and protect your energy output. So if the social media thing starts to, if it becomes too imbalanced to like your craft and your job, then it's time to take the breaks off of it. And so if once it stops being fun, you should stop, you know?
That is wonderful advice and very, very true. Yeah, I feel like any person, no matter what scale, you know, once you set yourself up to be a public figure, even if it's just anyone creating a Twitter profile, you do need to put up some sort of barrier. Obviously, 5 years is a long time to be working on any project. So if you guys, from where you are now, you're now filming past episode 100, but from sort of this vantage point, what advice would you go back and give yourself as you started the pilot, or episode 4 in Bree's case?
15, actually.
15, okay.
I mean, but who's counting?
Oh, you're
looking at me.
I'm looking at all of you.
Maybe David would have gotten a haircut earlier.
Find a very honest hand mirror. No, I would have just told my young little, my God, I've aged so much. But I would have said, just chill out. Just chill out. I was taking it all very seriously because it's a heavy thing to think to be on a show that's going. It's something you strive for, or I did at least, almost myopically. Is that correct?
Yep.
There's the relationship, guys.
Something you struggled for 3 years.
Oh, the pain I went through. No, it felt very big. And I would say, chill out one day at a time.
I think if we had been younger, when the show got picked up, it might have been a different situation. Like if we were like the cast of 90210 or something. But we're all like heavily in our mid-30s, mid-40s here. And so,
heavily seems like.
Heavily? It's like heavy cream.
We are now in, I mean, I was 30 when I booked it, now I'm 35. But you have this perspective.
Heavily. Heavy 35, though. It's a heavy 35. Yeah. She's lived.
You don't, you know, you realize by this point we'd been auditioning for a long time. We'd all been working and struggling and trying to make stuff happen. And so you kind of do take it with a grain of salt. And I think there's a tremendous amount of gratitude being a grown-up, being a struggling actor, working here and there, and then just getting on something and knowing that 9 months of the year you have a job and you're being paid and you get to act and you get to be an artist. And so that, and I also would have bought a house earlier.
That was gonna be mine
in Portland, because Portland, in the 5 years we've been there, that city has just boomed and exploded beyond. And I bought a house in April, and the woman before me bought it in 2012, and I am like, why didn't I not just buy a house season one?
You didn't have the money yet.
also true. Yeah.
I have to second David's thing, though, because it is like, you know, as you get into season five, your evolution, I guess, as an artist, as an actor, it's like the best things come from when you're like calm and like chilled out. Like the best work comes from when you're calm. And so we seem to enjoy it more now. Yeah. And, you know, when we're calmer and we're kind of into it and you experience these things that you're supposed to experience as an actor, you know, the joy of it, the fun of it. Because we get to go beyond the realm of just reality. And it, who knows, maybe it's real too. So, so I have to second that in the regard that as an actor, it's like, man, sky's the limit, you know, if you calm down. So I would do the same thing.
Now, you all had been working in TV before you landed roles on Grimm. What kept you guys going through the audition process as you went from role to role until you did land here?
Craziness.
To me, the trick of the whole thing is if you can have fun auditioning.
How did
that's
you have
a tough
fun?
One.
Because like, I miss that. I mean, I know like I kick myself every time I have that thought, but like every time pilot season rolls around. Because I remember every Friday I would sit in my car and just like cry. Every Friday of June, but it was like not, I mean, it was cathartic. It was like, okay, got through the week
good.
Again. Like,
good.
Didn't we admit we went to the Baja Fresh on Ventura and just cried?
and Bree and I, the first test I ever had in LA was for this MacGyver pilot.
MacGyver that they're rebooting
Bree,
now.
That they're rebooting again, so we're that old that now they're bringing it back again. But anyway.
We already rebooted the reboot. They rebooted the reboot.
The sun never
heavy
sets on MacGyver.
For me, it was a little different because I had been working for a number of years prior to the job, but what happened was I had hit a snag, and you know, I hadn't worked for about a year before I got Grimm, and I had hit like a tense moment, like a not really like a John Hamm moment, but it was like it felt like it was getting there, and and so you know, you try to say to yourself, let me relax, and it'll come, and people are trying to tell you positive things and think positive, and it doesn't work. You know what I mean? You know what I mean? Like, you know, I had a wife, I had just bought a house, and you know, my wife's like looking at me, I'm home playing Madden, and she's like, you know, UPS is hiring, you know what I mean? And I'm like, you know, like literally, like She came home one day, I'm playing Madden with my boy, and she's like, oh, really? Like, 6 months you've been out of the job and you're still playing Madden? Like, yeah, and I haven't played since. But, but you know, so then I, and again, I mean, I was very tense, and to the point where I was not able to do my best, you know, when I went into the room three times in a row. I had five auditions for this role. And the first three times, I was terrible. Literally just terrible. And, you know, I get on the phone the night before. So I had gotten, I guess because of the work I had done prior, they were like, listen, we know he can do it. We'll pass him through. And I'll never forget the night before, either the studio or the network test, I'm on the phone with my agent and my manager. And they're psychoanalyzing me. You know what I mean? Like, hey, Roz, what's wrong? Like, how come you're not doing the thing? What's going on? How you feeling? You okay? Like, da, 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 da. You need something? You know what I mean? And it's like, you know, we want this role for you. I said, and it's interesting. Because, forgive me for being indecent for a moment, but, like, you don't want this motherfucker more than I do. That's what I told them. You know what I'm saying? Like, I'm the one who got a wife in the house and I got a kid coming, you know what I mean? Like, you don't want it more than I do, so like, get out of my space and leave me alone, you know what I mean? And you had to like, you have to set up those boundaries, and you really, then that's when the moment when it's like, the rubber meets the road and you find out who you really are, you know what I mean? And then so, I had to like really sit with myself, and I'll never forget, it was beautiful. And looking back in retrospect, it was the most beautiful thing. My wife took off of work that day and she said, I'm gonna be here for you. You know what I mean? Like, you know, but just do your thing and, you know, I'll be here. So I wake up the next morning and I'm, you know, working on my audition and stuff like that. And she's just there, you know, and then she didn't have the TV on. She was just in the house. And then I went to go do the audition and I came back. And the most beautiful thing happened when I got back, just to see her there and to have someone support you, there to support you and there to love you, whether it goes your way or not, you know what I mean, was the most beautiful thing. And that's when I realized that I can keep going. You know what I mean? Because somebody that you loved, that you committed your life to, is saying, I'm here for you. And I didn't realize how important that was. And then, you know, a couple hours later, you're sitting there and you get the call, you're crying, you know, you get it, and you're like, oh, I got a job. And my wife's like, where are we going to eat tonight? You know what I'm saying? Red Lobster, you know? You know, and that's what changed my life. And so I tell this only because, you know, what is the old Billie Holiday? You don't know what love is until you've learned the meaning of the blues. You know what I'm saying? Like, when you, right now, whether you're working or whether you're unemployed, enjoy this shit. You know what I'm saying? Like, you have to, and it's easy for me to say that because I've been working, but I've been there. So it'll, you know what I mean? It will turn around, but you have to support yourself and you have to support others. That's very important because we are artists in this. We are sensitive about our shit. And you know what I'm saying? And not everybody gets that. They don't always understand it. But if we are here for each other, it can all be beautiful. So, you know.
That was lovely, Russell. Thank you. What has the experience been like for all of you, both good and bad, I'm sure mostly good, but working on the same project, the same show for 5 years, 100 plus episodes?
This has been a family from the get-go. It really has. We've dined together, we've gone on vacations together, we stay together now, so 100 in, it's the same thing, and I'm so happy
wherever
to be here.
You go,
wherever you do,
we're gonna go through it together.
I think we're all prepared for it never to be like this, because this really is a rare familial kind of event I'm just seconding, so it's rare.
To what Bitsie said about us being older, more mature, I think we get it. I think once we got to Portland and we were working, it's like, we get it. Like, we're lucky to be here.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So like, let's revel in this. Like, we're cool You cool? I'm cool.
Yeah, and I also have to give.
Let's all be that.
I gotta give credit to David, really, for you were like, you were young, you were dealing with like, what do you call it? A fire hose of information and shit to deal with, and having someone with his temperament and your sensibility and your kind of graciousness as the number one at the top of this whole madness 5 years ago, really,
very kind,
it's
man.
Really true. Like, helped true. Set very the tone. True. So true. Bless very you for true. That.
Thank you so much.
And I want to give a shout out to Portland, Oregon, because that city has welcomed us so much. And then Sasha spearheaded this OHSU Grimster Fund there, but we couldn't be filming in a better place. The people are wonderful. We've given to the community, they've given back, they're kind, it's a gorgeous city, it's close to LA. I mean, I love everything about it. Many of us have owned homes there now.
Is it Portland, Oregon?
That and I have to, well, we'll all chime in on this one, but that man back there, Norberto Barba.
Amen.
From the get-go,
yeah, Bert.
Who has been our rock.
One of our wonderful showrunners.
And I mean, we'd go to dinner at his house all the time. We'd be a knocking at his door.
He's kind of keeping it.
And Bert would have it open.
Forward.
I just want to celebrate. Sit on my lap.
What do you want for Christmas,
now,
kid?
Now I'm the puppet master. But I just wanted him to come up so that we could celebrate him and just let you all know that without him, we wouldn't be here either. Because this guy...
Or as tight as we are now.
Very true.
Roberto Barber, you want to say anything? Or you want to
it was great watching the episode with you folks. I sat in the back, and it was like being in a movie theater. And so it was, you know, 5 years, I've learned a lot, and we've bonded. And we have great writers, you know, David and Jim. I don't think I got one script late in 5 years. And that says a lot. So, you know, this is a special, it's been a special experience for me. So thank you all.
Thank you.
Thank you, Bert. We love you.
El Capitan.
You know, people always ask, what do you think the secret is? And as if, like, we know. As if anyone knows, because if they knew the secret, they'd be pumping it out every single season, right? But I think it's just, like, the perfect storm. Like, you just, people like Bert and our showrunners, this cast, just, you know, we got lucky. The city of Portland, the crew in Portland, like, it's just the perfect cocktail of people with, you know, just this kind of modesty who just want to focus on the work. And we got lucky, and I think that really is probably the secret of a lot of our success. Yeah.
Now, this is a very broad question, but what got all of you into acting? I know not everyone went to school for it. So what was sort of your acting origin stories?
I have to start just because my first role in third grade was Hansel in Hansel and Gretel.
No, I didn't know that. That's crazy. I didn't know that.
Did you not know that? I know. That's it's just amazing. Weird. So talk about full circle. And now after this, it'll spiral because I'm not going to stop just because I ended at a Grimm and started at a Grimm. So
I was really, really, really shy, and my parents were worried that I wasn't going to be like social. Like, I was too afraid of people, and so they don't know anything about any of this, and enrolled me in like audition workshop camp when I was five. And that was at this theater company called The Mountain Play in Northern California. And that was the King and I. And so just started doing musicals, and it, you know, it just kind of steamrolled from there.
Except for that.
I never. I played Mustard Seed when I was like probably eight, because
I
had to. But no, I was not an actress. I started relatively late in the grand scheme of things. I was about to go get my MFA in art history, and I took a year off and ended up in LA. And I think I must have had a little bit of an inkling that this is something I might be interested in. And I really fell into the hands of the right teacher for me, because I wanted to be challenged and I'd never acted before. And she handed me a Clifford Odets play, a scene from Golden Boy. And I was like, are you kidding me? And I fell in love, and I studied for a couple years, even though I was like very aware of the fact that I'm not getting any younger, and I'm already starting kind of late in my mid-20s. Well, you know, these days...
She was heavily in her mid-20s when she started. And look at her now!
But yeah, that's how it started. And then I was in jury duty and I met Marshall Herskovitz, and I ended up, the first thing I ever ended up doing was a show for Marshall Herskovitz in Edswick, and I was 25. So that's how it started for me.
I got going late. I went to theater school in my late 20s and got out when I was about 30, and wanted to be a theater actor. But this sort of kept happening, so I just kind of went with it. But I wanted to be an actor for a long time. I just didn't have the courage to do it, and I had a very immigrant family. So it was not, it was like lawyer, doctor, or both. And so that didn't work out. My brother's a lawyer, so.
You could sue yourself for malpractice.
Yeah, exactly. But I did, when I was 14, I did the very first production, theater production at Camp Redwood, where I played Danny Zuko in Greece. And yeah, they're still talking about it.
I was a dancer my whole life. So, you know, obviously on stage and in the arts, but never thought acting was part of my future. But I came to LA as a dancer. You know, being in the industry just kind of started getting me thinking, like, oh, maybe there's a future beyond dance. And so I probably got into my first acting class at 23. But I'm so grateful for my starting out as a dancer, you know, grueling in that industry for, you know, a decade, because what I didn't come to my acting career with was ego or laziness, because dance industry is, you know, very cutthroat and very rigorous. And so I'm really grateful for that, because that's always kind of where it started with me, was work hard, don't be lazy, and see where it goes, you know, so.
Does anyone else want to share their origin stories?
This is all I know. This is all I've done. I started out doing plays in high school, and then went and studied at theater school, and you know, had a tour, I like to call them, I did my tour of duty in New York. You know, and in the theater for quite a long time, and got a work ethic from, you know, working with older actors who really taught me what it means to be a professional, you know, to be to work on time, to be prepared, to, you know your lines, all that kind of stuff. And, you know, I jokingly would say, you know, I don't have a plan B, and because I don't, and I didn't, and you just, it's kind of kept pressing through. But it's been a great journey and a lot of fun, and you know, the crookeds with the straights, as they say, you got to take the crookeds with the straights.
I'm gonna chime in now. Come to think of it, Silas, my first role was as the Miller and Rumpelstiltskin. Yeah, I didn't even realize that until now. No, but I mean, what got me started, I saw this TV movie of the week called A Shining Season with this actor named Timothy Bottoms, who I now still regard as one of the most vulnerable, wonderful actors. His performance in that inspired me so much that I went to my parents and I said, I want to be an actor. And they said, no, because you're Asian and you can't. And there's... you're not going to work, you know? And I said, I'm going to do it. That's all I want to do. And I thought, okay, they just told me that. And so I've got a challenge. And I thought, okay, I'm going to learn to sing. I'm going to learn to dance. I'm going to learn to act. So I would walk to like a bus stop for a mile and go, I lived in Cleveland. And so I would like take the bus to the School of Cleveland Ballet or go to the Cleveland Playhouse, take a class. And because, you know, they didn't have the time to like kind of do that for me. In order to work as an Asian actor, I better be able to do all three things. So my goal was like, let me get to Broadway and then let's take it from there. So I started with doing musical theater on Broadway. So I did that, and then I was like, I'm done with this like 8 shows of singing and dancing and acting a week. But no, it was a wonderful experience. But acting was always where it was at. Circling back, I was filming Pirates of the Caribbean, and then I had a little bit of a break because it was a long-ass shoot. And then I did this independent film called Chinaman's Chance. I know. I know. It was about these two Chinese brothers that came over to work on the railroads, and they were adopted by these American families, and they cast and they cast my adopted father, and it was Timothy Bottoms.
Wow.
So I got to tell him that he inspired me to start
That's
all this.
So cute.
And I still think about him now, and I stay in contact with him. So
I guess I'm the only one left.
Yeah.
Okay, played Fagin when I was 9. St. Genevieve Dubois, St. Louis, Missouri. False beard, it all went well. I was a short little non-athlete, and I saw that that wasn't working for me. And I was a hit when I was Fagin, and I got like a standing ovation, and Oliver didn't. Drama. So I'm like, wow, this works. I can be funny and whatever, so that you get that feedback, and that's probably not healthy. Do things to love me. I'll dance. So, that's what I do now. But then it was St. Louis, Missouri. I was probably a latent actor for forever, but my family, you know, we just didn't know that outlet. So I ended up going into finance, and then I got under Road Rules, which was at my college town. Then I'm like, oh, cameras, what? Fagin, oh! and then I kind of, you know, my mid-20s, I drove to LA in my Volkswagen Golf, and it reeked in there. And I started, and I kind of, you have to be very disciplined, as we all know. It's a lot of grit, a lot of luck, and you have to be maybe a little bit talented. That was my origin story.
Those all were wonderful. They were superhuman, super actor origin stories. But one thing that's really interesting to me in hearing you all talk about it is, if I'm not mistaken, no one grew up in the greater LA area, right? And in fact, some of you actually grew up outside the United States. So
I think just one of us.
Well, no. Bitsie, you grew up in Spain.
Three countries to your helmet.
Yeah. Really? And then also, Reggie, you grew up your younger years
in the
Philippines.
So, and then moved here, but I was 6.
I think it's one of the best parts of our show is that we have, that Reggie got to speak Tagalog, and Sasha speaks Russian and French, and I've been able to speak Spanish.
They ask us about that, and they use it, they incorporate it in the show, which is very collaborative, which doesn't
really
happen.
I love that.
You got your ass
I got to speak
I
WASP.
Did.
It was fantastic.
But you know, being relative outsiders when you were breaking into the industry, what advice do you have, and how did you use that to your advantage when you were getting your early roles?
I went to Northwestern, and so Chicago had a pretty... really? Holla! Chicago had an industry there, and I just, you know, submitted all my stuff, and actually there was an agency there called Stewart Talent that had just lost Jennifer Morrison to Los Angeles, and so like we need a like, you know, suburban blonde girl. So I got the call, and I started auditioning. You know, I did like a I remember Blue Cross Blue Shield commercial. That was the first thing, and got my SAG card doing an episode of Mind of the Married Man, which they were there shooting exteriors, so that when I moved to LA, they knew an agency out here. So it was a very like I had the introduction already. So it was like, I'm big on own your small market, you know, farm league it out, and then come to town. That was what worked.
I had a similar experience because I grew up in Canada, and where a lot of people I think will be arriving shortly. Get your applications in, folks.
That searches of how to move to Canada have increased 1,000% in the past couple of weeks.
I know.
Fun fact.
I'll put in a good word for you. But the there's a huge market. It's Hollywood North, right? So there's Toronto and Vancouver specifically, and so I got a chance to work in those markets before I came here, which helped me a lot. But then, you know, I still moved here. I was 33 when I came to LA, so it's a little late coming in some ways, but you know, I just you just keep hustling. I mean, I think that's all you do in this career is just keep hustling all the time. Like, you just have to, you know, I was with some people who didn't work out that well and just found the right people at the right time, and they represented me in the way that I wanted to be represented and thankfully opened up opportunities for me.
I think what has saved me as an actor when in years of auditioning is you're the only one who's in the room making these choices, and you go in and you do your best and then you walk out and you let it go. And I honestly would just almost assume I wasn't going to get the job, and then if I got a call back, it would be great. But staying unattached, and more than anything, not taking it personally, because so often it has nothing to do with whether you had the best performance. You might be 5 years too young or too old, or you're just not what they're looking for. But you are in control of your decisions and how hard you work on it, and doing the best you can do in the room.
And not letting the dreaded words, they didn't respond, get to you. Because like I was saying, you just have to have fun. Go have fun and fuck it. Yeah. Have fun.
I want to say something before this whole thing closes down. Yes, like, why is it successful? How does it get to 100 episodes? Mystery. One of the key elements, though, is having someone like, I want to thank Bob Greenblatt, who kind of gave us the tap and we were allowed to move forward. And because it's a weird show. And want to thank all of the studio and network heads for hiring us.
In the first place.
Not that they don't know that we're thankful for that. And kind of having faith in letting a show that's so kind of strange and peculiar ferment and grow and
they
become,
continue to care about
and
it.
And they do. You so know, they thank you to them. Thank you very much.
And I do, before we shift over to some audience questions, I did want to give you guys a chance to talk a little bit. You mentioned the Grimster Endowment, but this is this really wonderful thing that you guys have put together, and the Grimm Gala, which you do once a year, which raises money to support families with children at the Dornbecker Children's Hospital in Portland. And you, beyond that, you all also have other charity endeavors. So I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about why that is so important for you guys, especially now that you've, again, been at the same show for 5 years and have this steady gig to give back and be involved in various charity endeavors?
You know, well, first, I think it's important to you know, understand that we take this pursuit in acting or being artists, and it's, you know, we have a singular focus. And at some point in our career, in our life, you have to put life first. You know what I mean? You have to, you know, there's times where you stop, you may get married, you want to have children, something like that, but you have to put life first. And I think for me, personally, being up in Portland and having the time once, you know, the day we wrapped on a day, it's like, what do you do now, you know? And so there's life out there, you know, there's you have an ability to influence, you have an ability to help, you have an ability to serve. And so you have to just then have the willingness. And I think for myself, you know, having the willingness to want to serve and help, you know, others is where it all started. But it really started just by saying, it's now time to put life first.
You know, I think we all know how great, like, how lucky we are. I hope it comes across. We never lost sight of the fact that we're very fortunate to be in this position. And I think at some point you realize that it's not enough to just feel fortunate. You actually have to give back to people with less fortunate situations. And so we started getting involved a lot with the Dornbecker Hospital, which is a children's hospital up in Portland, which is a very celebrated place. And started an endowment there to help families with all sorts of financial burdens that are uncompensated by their insurance and so on. And then we started with this gala a year ago, and we did a subsequent one just a few weeks ago, and we've raised over $700,000 so far with the help of Nike and Comcast and NBC and the whole city of Portland, because it's also been a fantastic place for us and a very kind place. It's a really amazing city. It's changed our lives tremendously. I think it was just time to give back.
Awesome. Well, all right, our first audience question comes from Paul Pinky Root. Where are you? There you are. All right, so
that's a great name.
He wants to know for the cast.
Paul was Pinky.
Fantastic actor, by the way.
Well, maybe this is a loaded question then. So for the cast, after 5+ years and over 100 episodes, where do you find the inspiration to keep pushing and striving to do the quality work you produce?
Never wanting it to end. This particular situation, it is really, like, honestly, just like, I don't, I just working harder and harder. And we all, like we've said, know how fortunate the situation is. So yeah, we better be busting our ass because I don't want this to ever be over.
We're all pretty fortunate to have a work ethic. I mean, everyone appreciates everyone, and when we're on set, we work. I mean, we work and we have a good time at it. And I think that that's the key. Also, the writers in the studio, they've never remained kind of, you know, complacent. The stories evolve. Each character evolves. It's not like, you know, you've stayed this person. It evolves, and they're not scared to take it to another place. It's sci-fi. So, and that has really kept you on your toes and been a joy.
Plus, you're up there, and, you know, your crew is killing themselves. You know, your crew is in the rain at night, in the cold for 18
Amazing
hours.
Crew.
And you show up like a hack. You know, that's like not okay. So it really is a team effort.
And in general, complacency is not a nice place to live, you know? Like complacency is kind of dead. So among all of those things as well, just generally complacency is kind of like lifeless. So you just keep trying to do the best you can do.
If you recall from even a moment what it was like before the show, which you do, then you go, I'm so lucky to be here right now doing this. Just revel in this.
All right, this one is from Davey Phillips. Davey, there you are. For the cast, and I believe this isn't too much of a question, but more a statement. From the very first episode, you guys had me hooked. Thanks for making Friday night watching a ghoulish good thing.
So. Right on, thank you.
Tweet that, Davey.
Davey.
Hashtag Grimm.
Thank you, man.
This one is from Terrence T. Terrence, where are you? There you are. Also for the cast. How did you feel getting cast in this show and finding out that it would shoot in Portland, Oregon?
Well, I'd never been up here, actually. I remember I flew in with David, and I have a photo. I was going through photos from 5 years ago, and I have a photo that I took from the airplane flying over Portland. It was March of 2011, and it was couldn't have been gloomier. And there were these like dead trees jutting out of these this like black water. And I was like, it looks like a set. I mean, it couldn't
be more
perfect.
The fairy tales are real down there.
Yeah, yeah. The feeling of being cast was amazing because the pilot episode script was so terrific. And knowing that Jim Kalf and David Greenwald were behind it, I kind of always was thinking that it might be a thing, that it might go. But, you know, when we book any job, we're like, it's the happiest moment in your life, you know?
Half the fun of working is like going out of town. It's like, you get a job, where am I going to go next? You know what I mean? So
The job is the fun. Yeah. The auditioning and the hustle is the work, you know? So
I was just glad it wasn't Dallas.
Sorry.
Sorry to Dallas.
We took prison break from Chicago to Dallas, and everyone wept because Chicago is such a great place to, you know. And then we went to Dallas, and it was like hot, and you had to walk like 4 miles to get a burger. And sorry, I'm a partisan. I'm sorry.
All right, this is from Janine to the cast. Janine, where are you? There you are. How many auditions did you have to go through before you landed your role on Grimm?
You mean for Grimm or in general? Oh, for Grimm.
For me, it was three. It was the producer session and then studio tests the next day and network test on Friday. It was very fast. Typically, that doesn't happen. You'll like test, and if you know you're going to test, maybe you have a week before the studio test, but I auditioned on a Wednesday, and Russell and I were together testing by the end of that week, so 3 days.
I had one, which is like the craziest thing in the world, because I have literally done so many pilots, and I have been almost cast in so many things that would change my life, and like so many times in my career. So the fact that the job that actually really changes my life and my career is cast on like on tape, you know, and I had to be there in 45 minutes, and I was like wearing, I had no makeup on and like had a dirty t-shirt, and I was like, fuck it, I'm just gonna go, fuck it. And honestly, I can thank Bert, who I've said before, but Bert was very responsible for my hiring of this job because I didn't see anyone, and that is like unheard of. So I thank you to Bert and to the universe and to everyone who signed off on me, because that was not usually how it goes.
I was off tape And I still have never been a series regular on a pilot, ever. Like, I did a bunch of, like, recurring stuff, and if it goes, you'll get bumped
series
up. And
regular in this?
No, but I've never done a pilot. Oh. So I was in the pilot as a guest star, potential, like, guest star, possible recurring. Well, like, possible you all know what that means. It's like, okay,
we'll
great.
See.
That's
we'll
that's
see.
That's like clickbait.
Yeah. Yeah, so...
I do remember Claire saying when we were filming the pilot, we were all going to go. That was our first time to go out to dinner. I think we went to the Ace Hotel to go to dinner. Yeah. And Claire was like, it's going to go, you guys, because whenever I'm cast as a recurring in a pilot, it always goes.
But then it's done. Like, I'd done all these, like, oh, but then, no, the previous year anyway, well. This was my first regular job ever, and yeah, I still have yet to be a series regular on a pilot ever. So this is pretty great.
I had auditioned for the part of Hank, and it was Russell and I and someone else, and I remember walking with Russell in the parking lot, and I was like, I hope you get it if I don't get it. And he got it. Damn it.
But I don't really
No. But then they called me later and said we liked Reggie and we'd like to create this role for him. And so I was like, that was a first. I was like, I had five other tests that year. I was like, when does an Asian test for even two in a season? And it
when
was
his
crazy.
Name is Reggie motherfucking Lee. That's when.
Oh.
Nobody doesn't like Reggie Lee.
But no, and then they said, Grace Wu said, yeah, only if you can add him if you name him after me. So Grace Wu is the head of NBC casting.
Oh,
I have to thank her because now hence Sergeant Wu was born. But yeah, four auditions.
I went in twice. One other time when I went out for the role of Monroe initially before Silas came on board. And then they brought me, they called me to come in for the captain, and I read and there was nothing on the page. It was like five lines here and there, and he's just very kind of mysterious. And I thought, I don't understand what they want from this guy. And I'm way too young for this. The hell with it. So I went in, and I walked into the audition room, and really diverse room. I couldn't understand where I fit in there at all. And so I was just totally disheartened. I was like, fuck, not one of these. And I'm not in the middle of pilot season. I'm so exhausted already. And then I went into the room, and because I was so kind of fed up, it was the end of pilot season. I was just done. I was done with this. And I gave the fucking best performance. I killed those five lines. And I'll never, because I just didn't care anymore. I was done. Just wanted everyone to leave me alone. And then I remember Todd Milner, one of our executive producers, just, it got quiet after my audition, and he just said, could you give them whatever you're drinking? And I thought, well, this looks pretty good.
So that's the secret, just be totally out. Fed
I,
up.
No, I think in some sometimes, yeah, can you just throw it all away and you just don't care. You just go in and just, you know, let yourself be.
This one is from Carl. Carl, where are you? Right there, for Detective Wu. You add a great level of humor to the show with your role.
You just got promoted, by the way.
Thank you. Thanks for the promotion, too. Yeah. I appreciate that. They'll never give me one.
They said Detective Chu, but I couldn't tell. especially building off the fact that you just said they sort of built the part around you. Did the original breakdown call for for someone with a comedic edge, or did you bring that quality from yourself?
I have always thought I've been horrible at comedy, and I get cast in comedies quite a bit. But no, I mean, it literally came off one line in the pilot. When Nick bumps into me at the police precinct, and I say, I guess I should have worn my airbags today. And I was like, okay, I'm going to start there. And it always starts with the script for me. So it always starts with whatever's there, and then I build from there. I started looking up, like researching sarcastic, why sarcasm happens, and why. And usually those people are the most insecure. And so, you know, kind of building from there, and then suddenly the writers were writing this stuff, and we just kept playing off of that back and forth, and now he's kind of evolved, and I love him to death, and I appreciate the appreciation. Thank you so much.
Was it important for you when Wu did join the Scooby Squad that he didn't lose his sense of humor about everything?
Yes. Even when we did the Aswang episode, you know, it was so wrought with, like, just finding out was all that difficult. And there's a part of me that is like, you know, like that. But the humanity of it is the most important part of it. The humor comes from the humanity. So the humor comes from the insecurity or whatever he's going through at that particular time. That's where I like to work from. That's what gives me joy. So it has to always start from there.
This question is from Josh, and I think it's a perfect last question for our panel. Josh, where are you? Right there. To any of the cast, during any low moments on your path to becoming a working actor, how did you maintain focus and keep the faith?
Have a life. Like, really, have a life. Have friends, have family, have a dog, go to the beach, ski, I don't care. Collect stamps. Like, have a life outside of auditioning. And also, I was going to say this earlier, I'm just going to say it, is that stay in class too. Like, never stop learning. Like,
we were just talking about this the other day.
I was
day.
In class until the day before I booked this job. If we shot in LA, I'd still be in class, you know? Like, because audition material is like five lines, you know? So how are you going to be stretching as an actor with five lines and like a breakdown that's like hunky beefcake with a limpy eye? I don't know. Like, I mean, I don't know what I'm saying.
I think that's an oxymoron. But,
but I just feel like, you know, it just doesn't ever stop. You just have to keep...
Stay in shape.
Stay in shape and keep growing.
Well, and also, like, what are you going to have to draw on in terms of, you know, humanity and emotion and experience if you're not out there actually living experiences? So I think that is a crucially important part of the job.
And the one thing I always noticed was you would hear when you weren't an actor or when you're a little outside of it, some major star, they're giving an interview and they say, oh, they were just about to quit. I'm like, and then I became an actor. I'm like, oh, wait, every actor is always just about to quit. So if you just don't, you'll be all right, you know?
Oh, I took the LSATs once. I was like, I need to study something that's not, you know, like, so I studied the LSATs and then took them. And I thought, like, oh, if miraculously I do amazingly, then it's like, oh, I've just missed my calling. And I did not.
And now you're a lawyer.
Now I'm a lawyer on TV.
On TV, the best guy.
Awesome. Well, thank you all so much for being here.
Let's have another
huge round of applause for 100 episodes.